Gildan Media, a division of Recorded Books, presents Money Mammoth. Harness the power of financial psychology to evolve your money mindset, avoid extinction, and crush your financial goals. By Brad Klontz, Edward Horwitz, and Ted Klontz. Narrated by Graham Rowat. Publisher's note. This audiobook refers to tables included in the print and ebook editions of the book. Foreword. Our attitudes toward money and wealth have far-reaching influence on how we live and lead our lives, perhaps more so than any other aspect of our social development. In my case, as a boy growing up on a farm in northeast Nebraska, I saw my parents wrestle with farmland debt, soaring prices on farm equipment, and bankruptcies that made it nearly impossible to keep the family business afloat. Though we made it through, the impact of seeing that struggle forever changed the way I thought about money. It changed the way I foresaw achieving financial security and led me to a career as a financial advisor. Nearly 40 years later, I built a top-ranked financial services firm serving tens of thousands of clients around the country, teaching them an undeniable truth about their financial behaviors. They underestimate the extent to which emotion plays a defining role in the success of their financial future. Chances are you have your own story with your own unique values, life lessons, and attitudes toward money. They've taught you some valuable lessons and probably exposed a few mistakes along the way, too. It's a relationship, really. We have our own connection with money that influences how we save it, invest it, or spend it. What is so profoundly powerful about this book is that it shines a light on how you develop these postures toward money and, more importantly, what you can do to adjust your own habits so you can make your financial situation work for you. At Carson Wealth, carsonwealth.com, we help our clients pursue true wealth, which is what we define as all that money can't buy and death can't take away. Using a holistic approach to financial planning and aided by technology, we discuss the emotions behind the decisions being made in a financial life. This experience connects the dots between life and wealth, making their financial situation easier to understand. A top client of ours recently came into the office for her annual review, and as she and the advisor were getting caught up, she seemed flustered. Longtime friends, the advisor's and client's children went to school together. The advisor picked up on her uneasy position and asked if she was feeling okay. She responded, "You've known me for a long time, and we've trusted each other, so I'm going to be direct with you." She replied, "I'm more scared coming in to see you than I am seeing my doctor." Surprised, the advisor asked why. "I just get nervous about money," she continued. "At least with the doctor, I know my results are either positive or negative. When it comes to money, I don't know exactly where I stand, and I feel intimidated by this area of my life because of how little I know. I want to do what's best for my kids, but I don't understand any of this, and it makes me really nervous." There are tens of thousands of stories just like this one. It underscores a scary reality about the psychological component interwoven into the fabric of our financial lives. Our anxiety over money is an issue that's as old as money itself. So, where do you go from here? Start by recognizing that financial psychology is the future of financial planning. The authors make a solid case for this, and brilliantly outlines how this issue is no longer simply an academic one. It's a personal one, and it will impact each of you in your own unique way. With every chapter, you'll be carried into a deeper layer of understanding of your own financial habits and, more importantly, equipped with an action plan on how you can make smarter decisions for your financial future. Think about the numerous beliefs you have about money. How have they influenced you up to this point in your life? What healthier habits can you adopt going forward? How can you go about building a more secure financial life for yourself and your family, equipped with this knowledge? These are all questions that will be answered in depth in Money Mammoth. My advice, as a financial advisor who sees just how far we've fallen when it comes to financial literacy, is to take these concepts and share them with everyone you know. Really, That's what I see being so powerful about this book. It forces you to not only look at yourself holistically, but also opens your eyes to the multifaceted way money infiltrates your thinking, your desires, your attitudes, and your future. If we intend to make smarter financial decisions and raise financially savvy children, this book makes it clear we must first start with ourselves. The more holistic your planning, the better your ability to make the right financial decisions. Whether you're a saver, spender, or investor, we are fortunate to have so much opportunity sitting in front of us. If you get nothing else from listening to this book, know this: every piece of who you are, whether psychologically, spiritually, emotionally, and physically, subtly intertwines with your feelings about money and shapes the way you see the world. The good news is the tools, concepts, and exercises in this book put the power in your hands to better understand your belief system and your habits, and how adjustments can be made to live more fully. As an advisor, I wish all my clients came to the table with the knowledge this book provides. A tip before you dive into the book: stop defending what you think you know and embrace the unknown. Open yourself to the realization you have much to learn, and often it's sitting within the depths of who you are, the people we associate with, and the environment in which we grow. What I'm talking about here is a lesson we often share with our clients. Let us help you live your life by design, not by default. As you listen on, use the principles in this book to be purposeful in your approach, to move forward in a smarter way, because the future favors the prepared. Ron Carson, CEO and founder, Carson Group. Introduction. Your Money Mammoth. Mammoths ruled their domain. Enormous creatures and majestic in their being, they lived at a time long after the dinosaurs were gone. Mammoths roamed the land of Western Europe and Northern America, eating grass, raising their young, and enjoying life. Changes in the mammoths' environment were happening all around them, but they failed to see and adapt to the effects. Over their time, the earth cooled, and as the tundra started to freeze, their food sources began to disappear. The mammoths started to migrate to find more sources for food, but they encountered new challenges. Neanderthal cave dwellers learned to communicate with in-tribes and learned to work together to hunt. Prehistoric humans evolved from the scavenger to the hunter and quickly ascended the food chain. The mammoths were slow-moving, large sources of meat protein, and sadly, easily killed. In the end, early human social hunting skills, a changing environment, and their species' failure to evolve and adapt was the source of the mammoth's eventual extinction. Our extinction-level event. Throughout history, species adapt and evolve over time to changing conditions, or they become extinct. It is a cruel truth of nature, a natural selection of survival of the species. However, don't be fooled into thinking these events only occurred millions of years ago. In fact, they're happening every day on our planet. You just may not be aware that they're occurring. While we instinctively look to environmental changes, like climate change, for examples of these events, they are not the only signs. Historically, environmental changes were the source of many early excitation events, but they aren't the only source of excitation-level changes. Some theorize that the extinction-level event that will impact humans may come from social versus environmental changes. Is it possible that the social phenomenon of not being able to properly handle our personal finances could lead to enough social unrest to cause a civil war? Can the underlying divide or political exploitation between the wealthy and poor grow to the point that the inequality destroys our social environment, leading to a quantum shift in our lives and society? In fact, it might not be the warming earth, pandemic disease, carbon emission, or a giant meteor that wipes us out. Consider the real possibility that our inability to address financial inequality and the number of people living in poverty as the foundational sources of our ultimate demise. Today's reality. When it comes to our relationship with money, we're stuck in the Stone Age. According to the American Psychological Association, APA, Money is a significant source of stress for 3 out of 4 Americans. 45% of Americans have no savings whatsoever. The average person age 60 or older who does have savings has about $150,000, certainly not enough to stop working. Almost 40% of American adults wouldn't be able to cover a $400 emergency with cash, savings, or a credit card charge they could quickly pay off. The median American household has only $11,700 in savings. Among elderly Social Security beneficiaries, 40% of married couples and 69% of unmarried persons receive 50% or more of their income from Social Security. In 2019, the average monthly Social Security retirement benefit for a new retiree was about $1,500. The level of credit debt in the United States during the height of the most recent economic expansion, 2019, was over $35,000. It's painfully obvious that the average American is in terrible financial shape, despite the relentless barrage of information and warnings from financial experts that saving for the future is not a luxury, but a necessity. In our society, people who don't save are looked down on. We blame them for being irresponsible without realizing that today's bad financial behaviors were our ancestors' essential survival behaviors. So who are you? Ask yourself if the environment you were raised in was one of financial independence or one of interdependence. Independence, in this case, means that every family unit within your tribe was expected to, and generally did, take care of itself. Or was it interdependent, meaning that everyone shared, when necessary, financial resources? If the latter, you may find it very difficult to save, while others close to you have significantly less. If your case is the latter, you may feel a great sense of responsibility for people who are in need. You may find that they expect you, if you have more, to share what you have. And if you don't, they may cut you out of their lives. You are wired to spend. You are wired to share and not save. That makes it a significant challenge to deal with modern personal finance. But we have another significant challenge. We are also hardwired to spend. Not all that we gathered is given away. We use it. We spend it now. We don't invest in our future. So why do we have that impulse? It's the same reason we have a problem with obesity. We can blame our DNA. Your ancestors did not live long by engaging in moderation. When there was something to eat, they ate as much of it as they could. They didn't say, "Oh, I think I've had enough. I'll quit now and save some for later." They didn't avoid eating fatty or sugary foods. They thrived on them. There were probably those who thought they should eat in moderation. But in prehistoric days, when people didn't know when or where their next meal would come, they were less likely to survive to pass on their DNA. So the survivors, our ancestors, were consumers, consuming as much as they could, even beyond when they were full. They did so because the next meal was not a guarantee, and any food that went uneaten would quickly spoil. This consumer programming helps to partly explain our current obesity crisis in America. We are no better at managing our calorie intake than we are at saving money. In many ways, money is our food. We love to consume it as we find it. If we get the chance, we will consume more than we need. But now we have the ability to consume more than we even have. We call this buying on credit. Businesses understand this human need and seduce us to consume our money, borrow more, and consume that too. They're just capitalizing on human nature. So modern society has created a situation in which our ancestral programming sets the stage for our becoming obese and broke. You are wired to try to keep up with the Joneses. In tribal life, ancestors' status within a tribe was a matter of life or death. One of the greatest threats to their survival was finding that they no longer belonged in the group, and they no longer had a community to help keep them safe. Our ancestors, left on their own, would not live long enough to pass on their DNA. So, today, we are incredibly sensitive to whether we belong in a group or not. We are wired to be on constant lookout for cues that we might have lost our place. In the past, it was critically important that our ancestors kept up on the latest gossip and rumors. Tribes typically consist of 100 to 150 individuals, so it was a daily task for our ancestors to see where they stood. It was important to know who was mad at them and who was in good favor with the leaders of the tribe. Given that our current society is so much larger, we rely on social media and the news to make sure we are not caught by surprise. Watching the news, whether accurate or not, triggers our pleasure centers and gives us hits of dopamine similar to those we get from food and sex. Our brain rewards us for keeping up with the Joneses. For our ancestors, keeping up with the news was a matter of life or death. All the rules have changed. Within the past two generations, there has been a dramatic shift away from this tribal social system. Part of the responsibility of the tribe was taking care of each other, including as older people. Over time, as we moved from small tribes to larger groups, this responsibility was passed on to institutions, corporations, and the government. Several decades ago, such entities were there to take care of the tribe. Your company would fund your retirement, and Social Security would step in to take care of the remainder. You saved a little for vacations and holidays, but when and how retirement would occur was not a concern. What about all this debt? Our grandparents didn't have credit problems. They didn't struggle with credit card debt. Were they wiser? More disciplined? Perhaps, but that's not why they didn't carry massive amounts of debt. The fact is that they couldn't have gotten access to unsecured debt if they wanted it. There was no such money mechanisms as credit cards. The only unsecured credit they were likely to get was from the local grocer, who wasn't likely to extend it more than $100 or less. In the past few decades, we have been given access to easy and fast credit. But recent cultural shifts have dramatically changed the landscape. Corporations have shifted from defined benefit plans, such as pensions, to defined contribution plans, like 401ks. These somewhat subtle shifts have changed the responsibility of saving for retirement from the institutions back to the individual. So we shifted the responsibility of taking care of our aging members from small tribes to the government. In the past few decades, institutions have been discharging this responsibility. But now there are no tribes left to fall back on. So now it is all up to the individual. This has never happened in human societal evolutionary history, and it is significant to note. You heard this message if you remember the daily briefings after the coronavirus outbreak, when self-reliance was called for and lack of government reliance became a reality. This dramatic shift alone helps explain, to a large degree, our society's current financial problems as well. Look at the total global economic impact of the coronavirus-related disruptions for businesses, organizations, individuals, and government, and the unintended results from these shifts of societal, personal responsibility. Who was most impacted? The poor and the elderly, those groups least able to take on the personal responsibility and who were most dependent on government systems. We must evolve. So, what can we do? The first step is to move away from lecturing, scolding, shaming, blaming, judging, scapegoating, and treating ourselves or others as if we are flawed or broken. We describe shame as an emotional glue trap that keeps you stuck. Shame is not helpful. Second, we need to develop strategies to overcome this basic wiring that was essential for our ancestors to survive in the ancient world, but works against us in today's world. This book is designed to help you understand your financial psychology, why you do the things you do around money. But we don't stop there. In each chapter, we offer tools to help you both tame your inner money mammoth and harness its powers to help you achieve your own ideal financial mindset. The winds of change. The message here is that, indeed, change is all around. Change is the one inevitable constant in our existence. Some change is for the better and helps us live happier and richer lives. But some change can threaten our literal existence as a species. How can we tell the difference and be prepared? After all, what doesn't kill us makes us stronger, right? However, if we become so smart as a species that we create automated workarounds to address these changes, will it make us weaker and softer? Will those changes sneak up on us like the proverbial lobster in the pot, unsuspectingly boiling us alive? Will we think we are living high and happy, relaxing in the hot tub of life, only to discover too late that we are becoming extinct? A historical moment. Will we look back at this moment in time and identify these financial trends as the cause of societal collapse which foretold our future? Is this the cause of our extinction? Are we like the mammoths, living in a world that is changing faster than we can comprehend or address? Or will the smartest and most enlightened of our species lead the way to change the trends that threaten our existence? Make no mistake, making behavioral change is hard, and doing so while fighting your genetic instincts will take some expert guidance. Time to evolve. Let's learn from the woolly mammoth and early humanity and adhere to the lessons evolution has provided. To avoid a life of pain and struggle, let's explore how to take action now through financial awakening and rewiring our financial behavioral actions. Let's evolve and become a new species, the money mammoth, who confidently roams the earth and thrives in this new, constantly changing world. Section 1. Your Origins. Chapter 1. Your Ancestors. This is the story of James and Alex, both of whom grew up in wealthy families. Both have more money at their disposal than they could spend in a lifetime. Both are surrounded by conspicuous luxury, and they've had the best education that money can buy. They eat the finest foods, they wear the finest clothes, and they run in the most elite social circles. They are financially set for life. In terms of material possessions, they have it all. Their wealth is not only profound, it is generational. Both come from families that have been wealthy for generations. Even though they come from similar places, they are very different people. James is a spoiled brat. His life consists of parties late into the night and sleeping in almost every day. He doesn't do anything productive. He doesn't work. He mistreats service providers. In fact, he can be downright cruel. Even though his parents have given him everything he wants, he resents them. He drinks too much, he eats too much, and he gambles incessantly. Inside, he feels bad about himself. He feels lost, purposeless, depressed. Alex, in contrast, lives a very different life. He wakes up early each morning and spends much of the day strategizing how he can leverage the financial gifts he has been given in ways that are consistent with his and his family's basic value of making the world a better place. He feels a sense of responsibility to be a good shepherd of the gifts he has been given. He is interested in knowing how he can increase his wealth so that he can do even more good things. He exercises rigorously to keep himself in peak physical condition. He's a practitioner of meditation and yoga. Though he didn't have to, he joined the military service, risking life and limb for his family and his country. He has spent years foregoing all of the pleasures that his family's money could have provided for him in an effort to make a name for himself and enhance the family legacy. He hopes to gain prominence as an officer and return home to enter politics. He's deeply connected to his family history. He appreciates what his parents, grandparents, and great-grandparents have done for him and his family. In fact, he knows all about each of them, how they each made a living, what they worked at, and what they accomplished. He is driven to elevate his family's wealth and its status, and to pass this legacy down to his own children and grandchildren as he helps make the world a better place. These two young men come from similar wealth, but have developed into very different people. Both were given every opportunity. One is passionate, appreciative, and ambitious. The other is depressed, resentful, and purposeless. It is human nature to seek pleasure and avoid pain, so it's easy to understand why someone like James, who has everything, might sit back and enjoy it. So this begs the question, why would an incredible, rich young man, someone who has more money than he could ever need, someone who is living in the lap of luxury and comfort, Why would he join the military, forego comfort and pleasure, risk his life, and be so utterly focused on growing his family's wealth and status? The Ancestor Room. To answer that question, we will visit ancient Rome. 2,000 years ago, Rome was the most powerful civilization in the world. Its aristocrats were incredibly wealthy. They lived in sprawling estates, had slaves to do their manual labor, and received the best education and health care available. The story of Alex mirrors that of many of the children of Roman aristocrats. The clearest path to wealth and status was political, and the quickest path to political office was a resume of military accomplishments. To this end, these young men would sacrifice all the luxury and comfort that Rome provided to travel thousands of miles away and risk health, life, and limb in the pursuit of military distinction. The short answer as to why young men behaved that way, it was all about their ancestors. Roman aristocrats had a tradition of making wax masks of the men in their families. The masks were usually made when someone reached the age of 40, and only if he had achieved a noteworthy political rank. The mask was a sign that he had achieved the minimal level of social status needed to be recognized as successful within the family. The mask showed that he was on a similar path to achievement and social prominence as his ancestors, who were similarly recognized. These masks were stored in the reception room of their atriums and were arranged next to labels of the highest political offices held by each person. They were worn by actors during funeral processions, but were also shown to visitors. Next to the collection of wax masks was a chart illustrating the family tree, with painted portraits of the ancestors. Nearby would also be a collection of armor and weapons captured by their ancestors, prominently displayed family achievements that would be seen by anyone who visited the home. Located in the entryway and near the center of the villa, these tributes to the family's history and accomplishments were displayed for all to see. It would not have been uncommon for the family to walk visitors through the space, showing off the military trophies and political distinctions, and telling stories about the trials, tribulations, and achievements of their ancestors. Imagine what it would have been like to have been a child growing up in such a home, hearing stories about the various artifacts, pictures, and accomplishments of your ancestors, which were so prominently displayed. What must it have been like to have been shown a sword taken from a Carthaginian officer by your great-great-grandfather in the Battle of Agrigentum in Sicily, or hearing about how your grandfather helped restore Roman honor as a general in the Battle of Carthage in North Africa? This deep connection to the past would help you make sense of the privilege you were now enjoying, and more important, the sense of duty and responsibility that accompany your privilege. Imagine how your self-esteem would be bolstered as you were told that you, as a direct descendant, have the same blood coursing through your veins, that the traits of courage and wile are built into your very being. You would believe that the highest levels of accomplishment for you are not only possible, but are expected, that your ancestors are watching you, supporting you, and encouraging you to take the family to the next level. It is not hard to imagine that growing up in this way, you might develop an intrinsic motivation to do your part to maintain and grow your family's wealth and status, and the belief that you could do it. So what's in your ancestry room? When was the last time you visited someone's home and saw busts and portraits of their ancestors lining their walls? Interestingly, some of the most generationally successful families do have pictures of their ancestors displayed prominently, but for most of us, this is just not the case. It makes sense, though, because, for rare exceptions, many of our ancestors never achieved significant fortune or status, and few could afford an artist to paint a portrait. Many Americans are the descendants of immigrants. Aside from the occasionally wealthy adventurer, no one in their right mind would choose to leave a life of wealth and privilege to get on a boat and travel across the world to start over in a country where they knew no one and often didn't even speak the language. If there were busts of your ancestors, with the possible exception of your parents or grandparents who may have been able to capitalize on the opportunities for socioeconomic advancement, the busts would likely not be of those who accomplished great things as measured in our culture or by ancient Roman standards. Instead, you would see pictures and artifacts of refugees, indentured workers, slaves, and immigrants. For most Americans, you would be looking at the historical legacy of poverty. Many of our ancestors came to America in an attempt to escape the depredations of political upheavals, poverty, calamity, disease, and natural disaster, or were forced to come here against their will. For many of us, our more recent ancestors would be represented by the tools and artifacts of farmers, auto workers, government employees, cooks, or laborers. So, if you closed your eyes and imagined the Hall of Fame for your ancestors, what would you see? What financial legacy did they pass down to you? What beliefs about money did they pass on to you? What beliefs about what is possible did you inherit? Why aren't you rich? If you're like many Americans, your family has been in the land of opportunity for generations. So why weren't more of us born into ultra-wealthy families? Take a moment to answer this question for yourself. Your most valuable answer in terms of truly understanding yourself will be the first thought that popped into your mind. You may be tempted to modify this so that it sounds more rational. Resist the temptation and stay with the image that first popped into your mind. Let the implications of that belief unfold. Just let it flow. If your ancestors achieved financial success, congratulations! Now, that doesn't mean that they passed this down to you, but hopefully you have benefited from either the resources they were able to build or the mindset that allowed them to become successful. But if you are like most of us, ask yourself this question. Why weren't your ancestors rich? So, why aren't you rich? The answer is simple. You and/or your ancestors didn't successfully hoard enough money or valuable objects. Of course, there are a plethora of other considerations, but in strict behavioral terms, that's pretty much it. Rich people have amassed a bunch of money for themselves. Poor people have not. It turns out that high financial net worth is not about how much money you make, it is defined by how much money you save. Here are two possible causes for your ancestors not becoming wealthy. The first is that they were dedicated to the concept of saving money, but they were unable to do so because the money or the opportunity to learn about money was not afforded them. This would include having been the unfortunate victims of oppressive governments, discrimination, or any number of atrocities throughout human history from which they were not able to recover. The second possible cause is that they didn't buy into the concept of hoarding. According to dictionary.com, hoard is defined as a stock or store of money or valued objects, typically one that is secret or carefully guarded. There are several key elements to this definition. First, it requires someone to stock up and save money or valuable objects. Second, it requires someone to protect, preserve, and safeguard the hoard. The great news about this is that if you are listening to this book, you likely live in a free society where people just like you have been able to create financial success. So while institutional and/or cultural barriers exist, it is possible for you to overcome them. Today, we honor hoarders of money and resources. If you are not among them, it would be normal for you to feel bad about yourself. You may ask, why were they able to do it, and me and my ancestors failed to do it? But here's the thing. While today we honor hoarders of money, thousands of years ago, we killed them. Death to savers. The majority of us are just not wired to save. In a 2018 study published in Nature Communications titled Differential Temporal Salience of Earning and Saving, researchers Kaesong Hu, Eve DeRosa, and Adam K. Anderson found that we are wired to pay more attention to earning than saving. They noted that savings are for future use, are currently inaccessible, and are abstract, which decreases our attention and motivation to save. In contrast, we are wired to focus more on earning or gaining money and possessions now, which is much more concrete. Not only are we wired to pay attention to immediate, concrete gains versus long-term, abstract savings, our ancestors survived by sharing what they had when they had it. Those who didn't share were sanctioned by the tribe, often quite dramatically, sometimes banished, sometimes publicly executed. The ultimate sanction was to be thrown out of the tribe, which was a prescription for certain death. The sharers survived, and so they passed on their sharing genes and became the dominant group with the trait of sharing. In many contemporary settings, the bias towards sharing instead of saving for oneself is very much predominant. For example, this approach to resources is quite prominent in Appalachia, Native American tribes, many African American communities, poor neighborhoods, and others. Those members of the community who share what they have with others are venerated, while non-sharers are sanctioned. An underlying premise is that if I look out for you when you need help, then you will look out for me when I need help. Each generation has its share of hoarders, but the majority of our ancestors, those individuals who survived, were those who had a sharing bias. At this point, you may be wondering about your money beliefs. Where did they come from? Did they evolve from my ancestors thousands of years ago? How much of my financial behavior is hardwired and on autopilot, and how much can I really control? Can I really fight genetic tendencies against saving? And if so, how? Can I become aware of my tendencies and correct them, or am I doomed for financial extinction too? In the next chapter, we begin to explore those and many other questions. But first, we need some mammoth insights to lead us on our journey. Chapter 1, Mammoth Mindset Insights. 1. Wealth can be a tool for happiness, but not the only source. 2. Setting expectations for greatness can occur through ancestry education. 3. Ancestral expectations can help build intrinsic motivation to achieve. 4. Sharing understandings and expectations of wealth can be generationally powerful. 5. Our early ancestors who evolved and survived had a sharing bias. 6. Setting an exception for savings and financial independence is very important. Chapter 2. Your parents. You are a product of your parents, and so is your relationship with money. Take a moment to think about your parents and their experiences around money. Did they grow up wealthy, poor, middle class? What was it like for them? Were they satisfied with their socioeconomic status as kids? Were they dissatisfied? Did they feel shame about having too little or too much compared to those around them? Were they raised knowing that they would have family financial support when they needed it, or were they cut loose at an early age, knowing they had to sink or swim on their own? What lessons did your grandparents teach them? What cultural and/or historical events impacted their relationship with money? How would you rate their satisfaction with their financial status in adulthood? Were they happy with their achievements? Did they feel remorse or despair? Don't be surprised if you don't know the answers to these questions. After all, money is a taboo topic in our culture. Many of us feel shame around money, and it can be difficult to think about, let alone talk to your children about. However, your parents' experiences around money have had a dramatic impact on your relationship with money. Shedding light on their experience can help you make sense of your own financial beliefs and behaviors. If your parents are still alive, we encourage you to sit down with them and interview them about their relationship with money. If not, try to interview aunts, uncles, or cousins. Ask them questions about your grandparents and any stories about your other ancestors. In terms of understanding and mastering your own financial psychology, uncovering the details of your family history is pure gold. Now think in terms of how your parents raised you around money. How was money handled in your home? How was it talked about? Did your parents agree about financial matters? Was money a topic of disagreement or conflict, or was it avoided altogether? What did your parents teach you about money, either overtly through instruction or by example? When you take the time to explore your parents' experiences around money, you will make better sense of your own financial beliefs and decisions. As a child, you watched them closely. They created the universe in which you were raised. They created the initial structure on which you built your money mindset. Their beliefs about money have had a powerful impact on your own financial psychology, for better or worse. Your parents. As you think about your parents, their relationship with money, and what you learned, what feelings emerge? Our relationship with our parents is complicated, made up of a mixed bag of feelings and experiences over the years. Due to the nature of our species, we rely on the care, feeding, and protection of our parents longer than any other animal. As a result, we are more influenced by our parents than any other species. This is also where we get most of our socialization, how we make sense of relationships, our sense of self, and the various roles we play. For better or worse, you entered the world as the socialized and behavioral result of what you saw your parents say and do when you were very young. Typically, by the age of 7, your personality, behaviors, and social beliefs are fairly well cast. When it comes to our beliefs and behaviors about money, research has supported a similar pattern of learning. What we see, hear, and overhear about money and relationships can influence us for our entire lives. These early childhood experiences create our money beliefs, which are hardwired into our subconscious. Our money beliefs drive our financial behaviors and in many ways determine our level of success. The subconscious representation of your financial beliefs, which greatly influences your money behaviors, decisions, and relationships, is known as money scripts. They are what informs our day-to-day interactions, decisions, discussions, relationships, filters, and behaviors regarding all things financial. Since money scripts are so integral to our financial outcomes, it makes sense to know as much as we can about them. We dedicate Chapter 9 to understanding and assessing your money scripts. For now, we're going to explore what roles your parents played in shaping your money beliefs. Essentially, it could be fair to blame your financial problems and possibly your relationship problems on your parents. Most likely, your financial beliefs and behaviors have sprung directly from your experiences in your childhood. Of course, you are ultimately responsible for your behaviors, but the fact is, your financial behaviors are rooted in your money scripts. Research on money scripts and their influence on financial outcomes is one of the fastest-growing areas of research in financial psychology. Financial professionals realize that understanding financial behavior is the future of helping clients with their financial needs. Become your own anthropologist. Anthropology is the study of human societies and cultures, and is a fascinating field. In studying a culture, anthropologists often immerse themselves into the culture, spending months or years living among the inhabitants. There, they both participate in the culture and observe the inhabitants, looking for insights into people's behavior from a cultural perspective. Since you probably can't afford to hire an anthropologist to live with your family for a year to study you, you need to do your own research. This is where interviewing your parents, siblings, and other family members can be so valuable. In this process, it is not uncommon to discover stories you have never heard. Sometimes these stories shed light on your parents' behaviors around money. Take the opportunity to interview your family members, asking some of the following questions. What was it like for you growing up around money? How was money handled by your parents? What was it like for grandparents growing up? How did you feel about your socioeconomic status? What beliefs about money were passed down to you? What were your biggest financial mistakes, successes? Do you have any memories that stand out? Often, these prompts will start an extended dialogue about their money memories. This is a good opportunity for you to listen. Take the time to let them share their memories and experiences around money. You might want to record the conversation and/or take notes. After your interviews, take some time to see if you can see any patterns. Did you notice any recurring themes? What beliefs did they have about money? Did you notice any differences between the childhood experiences of your parents? How did this impact their relationship with money? Do you recognize any of these beliefs passed down to you? How did their upbringing impact the development of your relationship with money? This type of study can be quite valuable and will give you tremendous insight into your own psychology of money. You might begin to better understand why your parents raised you the way they did. Your parents are as much a product of their parents and early environment as you are a product of yours. Keep in mind that your children are the next in line to inherit this family financial legacy. The great news is that it is not too late to make edits to your family legacy. When money helps. Having disposable income and using it to help friends and family can be a wonderful resource. Money can be used to help in times of opportunity, transition, or need. Financial support can be used to help loved ones with a down payment for a first home, education, weddings, moving expenses, or starting a business. Having parents or other family members there to help can provide a deep sense of safety, security, and confidence, even if the help is never asked for or received. As a parent who is able to help financially, the opportunity to help can provide a tremendous feeling of importance, dependence, and connection to an older child or grandchild's life. We all know that early on in our lives, we have built very little financial savings, wealth, or independence. Having a parent there to give us a leg up with life's initial financial challenges can be a real benefit. Whether this help comes in the form of a gift or a loan, having support helps satisfy that deep, tribal need we have for connection. When money hurts. But not all financial help is good. There are many circumstances in which financial help, or the promise of financial help, can hurt. For example, there are times when financial support enables a pattern of irresponsible financial behaviors, encouraging bad spending habits, a lack of saving, a lack of motivation, or other self-destructive behaviors. In our research, we refer to this as financial enabling and financial dependence, which is discussed in detail in Chapter 3. Sometimes money is used within family systems to hurt or control. Sometimes the power money can have to create a connection in the lives of those close to us becomes so important that we use money to enable those feelings. This can lead to a pattern of financial enmeshment. Financial enmeshment. Financial enmeshment is a blurring of boundaries among family members around money. Our research has found that financial enmeshment occurs more commonly with higher-income males, but it can afflict anyone. One example of financial enmeshment is when parents give children too much financial information or involve them inappropriately in adult financial matters. Common examples include using children to pass along financial information between divorced parents. For example, please tell your mother to pay me the $100 she owes me. Sharing your financial stress with a child. For example, I don't know how we are going to pay rent this month. Having children answer the phone when creditors call. Talking poorly about a child's parents around money. For example, you can't have braces because your father won't pay child support. Involving children in adult financial matters can have a negative impact on their own relationship with money. While some children may feel a sense of importance that they are being involved in adult matters, they are not psychologically able to cope with and process the information. As such, the experience often leaves them feeling anxious and insecure. It is very important to talk to your children about money, but it is not okay to share too much financial information with them. A great litmus test on what is too much is to ask yourself this question. Am I feeling negative emotions around this issue? For example, scared, guilty, or anger? If so, you are best not to share it. A better idea is for you to share those concerns with another adult, possibly even a professional. There is no shame in having financial stress or concerns, but you need to be careful not to burden your children with your issues, as it can hurt them. A family story of financial destruction. The Allen family came from humble financial beginnings. Fred, the father and sole breadwinner, was a science professor at the local university. The family had to stretch Fred's meager salary across the entire family, which consisted of his wife, Jane, their two daughters, and one son. As with many fathers of his generation, Fred was not very close with his children. He was a bit of a mad scientist type who was always working on some ideas in his office or in his home laboratory. The Allen family lived typical lower middle class existence through the 1950s, 1960s, and 1970s. Then in the 1980s, Fred's line of research led him to develop something revolutionary. After splitting the rights to the idea with the university, Fred quit his job and went into business. Fred took his innovation and built a business that became worth hundreds of millions of dollars. The company was held entirely by Fred and Jane as it grew organically. The Allens became very wealthy later in life when they were well into their 60s. But Fred and Jane, never having any real money, had no idea how to manage their newfound wealth. They wound up giving all their children tens of millions to help make their lives easier and more enjoyable, and so that their grandchildren would not need to struggle like they did. One of the three children joined Fred in the business to learn and ultimately take over someday. 20 years later, Jane passed away and left unequal portions of her wealth to each child. The two kids who were not involved in the business received assets and cash of $100 million each. The child working in the business received far less in dollars than the other two by half, but inherited Jane's shares of 50% ownership in the business. At the time, the two receiving cash were very happy and had no interest in the business at all. All three felt the division of assets was reasonable and fair. The other sibling worked hard to build up the business and succeed Fred as his days actively involved in the business were drawing to a close. After another 10 years, the kids who got money had spent an overwhelming amount of their inheritance and battled personal relationship issues and substance abuse. When the money was running low, the other two siblings saw how successful the business had become and felt they were shortchanged on their mom's estate settlement. This kicked off a series of lawsuits and resentment among the siblings. The one sibling was deeply hurt and angered that the hard work and dedication he had contributed to grow the organization was believed to be owed to the other two siblings who partied away their money. The two siblings co-opted Fred, who had become severely afflicted with dementia, and ganged up against the single sibling who was now controlling and running the organization. Finally, to save any remnants of their family and to help reconcile while Fred was still alive, the one sibling agreed to sell the company and settle. Unfortunately, they began fighting about the valuation and at what price to sell the business. Fred passed away years ago, and his 50% of the business was divided among the children, who are now in their 60s and 70s. However, the three siblings are still embroiled in ongoing lawsuits. The one sibling still has a controlling interest in the business and runs the organization very successfully. The kids have now been fighting in the courts for over 15 years, and their families never speak. They've been fighting so long and their bitterness is so deep, it's doubtful they can even remember what exactly they are fighting about. All three families should be set for life, each with hundreds of millions of dollars. However, instead of enjoying their wealth and the time they have left, they waste time and money fighting over a few million here or there. Fred and Jane's children had children of their own, all of whom were exposed to exceptional levels of wealth growing up. The family had many private jets. Anything the children wanted, they got, and their children's weddings were like royal affairs. Fred and Jane's children provided everything for their kids, so they never wanted or felt deprived. New York townhomes, Hollywood apartments, sports cars, and a healthy allowance were all lavishly provided to them. Almost all of Fred and Jane's grandchildren have subsequently struggled with failed relationships and substance abuse as well. Very soon, they will have children of their own. How do you think their life stories will unfold? This story is not that unusual for situations like these. Do you think the Allens were happier when they were middle class or super wealthy? Do you think that having more money will really make life better and make your family happier? Research would beg to differ. Studies consistently show that above middle class, there's no significant correlation between money and happiness. Parents know best. When we are young, we see our parents as people who always know the answers. That's probably why, as soon as we can think independently, around the ages of 4 to 5, we start asking a lot of questions. Parents try to answer these questions in a way that a young mind can comprehend, and in a way that is likely to end the barrage of questions. However, when it comes to learning lessons about money, our parents' answers to these questions get written into a money blueprint. Even worse, a passing comment about money...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.